بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، أهلا بيكم. أسنان دولي أناتوميتون. في محاضرة اليوم إن شاء الله هنشوف السيرفيكال فيرتبري، سيرفيكال فاشيا، بوستيرو نيك تريانجل. السيرفيكال فيرتبري identifying the first and second cervical vertebrae as they are different from all other vertebrae. Identifying the typical cervical vertebrae. Also, we have to know the different cervical articulation and the structures that connect the vertebrae together, which may be ligaments or membranes. The first cervical vertebrae is unique as it is different from all other vertebrae in the vertebral column. As we see, that is a superior view of the first cervical vertebrae, which is called atlas. It has no body. Instead, it has two lateral masses. The two lateral masses are connected together anteriorly by the anterior arch, having anterior tubercle, and the posterior arch having a posterior tubercle. And the lateral mass carries the articular surfaces or articular facets for articulation of the skull superiorly or second cervical vertebrae inferiorly. Also, the lateral mass projecting from the lateral mass laterally is a bony process which is called the transverse process, which have a foramen which is called the transverse foramina or foramen transversorium. The inferior view of the first cervical vertebrae or atlas, that is the articular facet for axis or second cervical vertebrae. The second cervical vertebrae is also unique in shape as it is different from all other shape of cervical vertebrae or all vertebral column. It has a body projecting from the body upwards, a bony process which is called dens. The dens has articular surface or articular facet from its posterior and the anterior surfaces. And this one is anterior articular facet which articulate with the arch of the atlas. It also has severe articular facets which articulate with the atlas superiorly and the inferior articular facet which articulate with the third cervical vertebrae inferiorly. And that is the anterior view of the second cervical vertebrae. Posterior view of the second cervical vertebrae, that is the body, and that is the dens, and that is the articular surface which articulate, the posterior articular surface which articulate with the transverse ligament. And that is the spine which has a very characteristic feature, which appear bifid in shape. All other spines in the vertebral column are not bifid. Once we see bifid spine, this is a very characteristic feature for all cervical vertebrae except the atlas, because the atlas has no spine. Also, that is a transverse process which have a transverse foramen, which is called the foramen transversorium. The first and second cervical vertebrae articulate together. In the median plane, they articulate by median atlantoaxial joint. In this median atlantoaxial joint, articulation between the dens of the second cervical vertebrae and the anterior arch of the atlas. And this joint is synovial of bifid variety. And through this joint, rotational movement of the head occur between the inferior articular process or inferior articular surface of the lateral mass of the atlas and the superior articular surface of the axis, a second joint called the lateral atlantoaxial joint. Articulation of all cervical vertebrae from the second to seventh. All cervical vertebrae articulate together, and that is a side view, that is the body of cervical vertebrae. And that is a transverse process which has foramen transversorium. And that is the articular process articulation between the articular processes, which is called apophyseal joint, and that is the spine of all cervical vertebrae. The spine of all cervical vertebrae. The longest spine of all cervical vertebrae is the spine of the seventh cervical vertebrae. Cervical vertebrae from 0 to 6 are being typical. All have body, transverse process having foramen, pedicle, lamina, and the spine. And the spine has a characteristic feature which is bifid, appear bifid in shape. Vertebral foramen and transverse foramen. Cervical vertebrae number 7 is being atypical. It has the same characteristic feature of typical cervical vertebrae except for the spine. The spine is long, more horizontal, and non-bifid, as it appears in this view. The ligaments and the membrane attached to cervical vertebrae or cervical vertebral column. Here is the ligamentum nuchae or nuchal ligament, triangular shaped ligament extending from the base of the skull, attached here to the external occipital crest, and its anterior border is attached to the spine of all cervical vertebrae, and its posterior border can be filled subcutaneously in the midline of the neck posteriorly, starting from the external occipital protuberance, all the way down to the spine of 7 cervical vertebrae. It completely separates the right side of the neck from the left side and the neck posteriorly. The gap between the first cervical vertebrae, which is called the atlas, and the base of the skull is closed anteriorly and posteriorly. It is closed posteriorly by a membrane called the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane, and also closed anteriorly by a membrane called anterior atlanto-occipital membrane. The median extension of the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane is called the ligament, which is called anterior longitudinal ligament, which connects the vertebral bodies anteriorly in the median brain. Cervical fascia. The deep cervical fascia lies deep to the superficial fascia and the platysmal muscle. And this fascia is organized into several layers. These layers act like a shirt collar supporting the structure and the vessels of the neck. The first layer of this fascia is called the investing fascia or investing layer. It is the most superficial of the deep cervical fascia. It's around all the structures in the neck where it meets the trapezius and the sternomastoid muscle. The investing fascia can be thought of as a tube with superior, inferior, anterior, and posterior attachment. Its superior attachment to the base of the mandible, styloid process, mastoid process, and external and superior nuchal line. Anteriorly, it is continuous with the investing fascia of the opposite layer, and inferiorly, it is attached to the spine and the acromion of the scapula, and also attached to the clavicle. The pretracheal fascia lies anteriorly in the neck. It spans between the hyoid bone superiorly and thorax inferiorly. And it encloses inside it the thyroid gland. Its downward extension reaches the posterior mediastinum. the prevertebral fascia, surrounds the vertebral column, and its associated muscle, scalene muscle, prevertebral muscle, and the muscle of the neck. Severe attachment to the base of the skull, and its anterior attachment to transverse process and the vertebral bodies of vertebral column. The carotid sheaths are paired structure on either side of the neck, which encloses the important neurovascular bundle of the neck. So it contains inside it the major blood vessels, major arteries, veins, and the nerves of the neck. It contains the carotid arteries, the internal jugular vein, the vagus nerve, and near the base of the skull, it also contains the last four cranial nerves. Sagittal view, that is the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, that is the pretracheal fascia, that is the buccopharyngeal fascia, and that is the prevertebral fascia. The investing layer anteriorly in the median plane divide into two bands or two layers, one anteriorly and one posteriorly, attached to the anterior and the posterior border of the maniobrum sternae, and leaving a space in between them, a fascial space called the suprasternal space of Pernes. The posterior triangle of the neck. Posterior triangle of the neck is an anatomical space in the posterior neck, surrounded by muscles and bone, and floored by muscle, and roofed by skin and fascia. Being an anatomic space, we have to know its boundaries, structure forming the floor, structure forming the roof, and its contents. The boundaries of the posterior triangle, anteriorly is the posterior border of the sternomastoid muscle, and posteriorly is the anterior border of trapezius. The base of the triangle is inferiorly and formed by the clavicle, and its apex is directed upwards. That is the sternomastoid muscle, that is the clavicle, and the trapezius muscle. The muscular floor of the triangle is formed by five muscles, starting from below upwards: scalenus anterior muscle, scalenus medius, levator scapulae, splenius capitis, and semispinalis capitis. The roof of the triangle is formed by skin and the fascia. The skin, superficial and deep fascia of the neck, which is the investing layer here. Here in this view, we see the anatomic space, the anatomic triangular space, which is called the posterior triangle of the neck. But its roof is removed. When we try to roof it by the structure removed, the first structure is the investing fascia, which is the deep fascia of the neck here. It's called the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, which have five holes. And through these holes, the deep nerve is coming from the posterior triangle of the neck, passes through the deep cervical fascia, and they become distributed to the skin of the neck inside the superficial fascia. And these nerves are called lesser occipital nerve, and then great auricular nerve, and then transverse cervical nerve, and lastly, supraclavicular nerves. Also, inside the superficial fascia, we can see a large vein superficially, which is called external jugular vein, that comes from superficial to deep. And in the lower part of the posterior triangle of the neck, it passes deep in the posterior triangle of the neck by passing through the investing fascia to drain into the subclavian veins. And then all these structures are covered by the skin. Again, when we try to dissect the posterior triangle of the neck, first we remove the skin. After removing the skin, we will see the superficial fascia. Superficial fascia containing the following structure. The cutaneous branches of cervical plexus and the external jugular vein. And then the deep cervical fascia, the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. The contents of the triangle, the posterior triangle of the neck contain nerves, blood vessels, arteries or veins, and the muscles. The nerve contents of the posterior triangle of the neck, the cutaneous branches of the cervical plexus, which are lesser occipital nerve, great auricular nerve, transverse cervical nerve, and supraclavicular nerves. It also contains the spinal part of the accessory nerve, which is the 11th cranial nerve, and also contains the root and trunks of the brachial plexus between the scalenus anterior and the scalenus medius muscle, forming the floor of the triangle hairs. That is the nerve contents of the posterior triangle of the neck. The vascular contents, the blood vessels, the lesser is the occipital artery, the transverse cervical artery, the suprascapular artery, and subclavian arteries. The veins is the external jugular vein and subclavian vein. The occipital artery is a branch of from external carotid artery, as you will see later. The transverse cervical artery and suprascapular arteries are branches from cervical trunk of the first part of subclavian artery. And the external jugular vein is mostly superficial in the neck, in the lower bar, in the lower third of the neck, and passes through the deep fascia from superficial to deep inside the posterior triangle to drain into subclavian vein. That is the cutaneous branches of cervical plexus, which appear at the middle of the posterior border of the sternomastoid muscle, and then passing through the investing fascia, and they become distributed in the superficial fascia to the skin of the neck. And these branches are, again, the lesser occipital nerve, the great auricular nerve, the transverse cervical nerve, and supraclavicular nerves. All comes from the nerve root from cervical 2 and 3 nerves, except the supraclavicular nerve from cervical 3 and 4. Outlining the posterior triangle of the neck. After making a deep dissection in the neck, here is the posterior triangle outlined by the blue lines. Here is the spinal part of the accessory nerve, the trunks of the root and the trunks of the brachial plexus. Also, that is the transverse cervical artery, and that is the suprascapular artery. And here is the subclavian artery and the subclavian veins. Together they are called subclavian vessels and omohyoid muscles. Applied anatomy of the posterior triangle of the neck are mainly restricted to external jugular vein. The external jugular vein begins near the mandibular angle, as we see in this diagram here. Just below or within the substance of the parotid gland. It descends along the side of the neck, superficial to sternomastoid muscle. Upon reaching the clavicle, it crosses the deep fascia from superficial to deep and ends by draining to subclavian vein. The external jugular vein has a significance in everyday clinical practice. And through this external jugular vein, cardiac catheterization can be performed. The central venous pressure. Measuring the central venous pressure or the pressure inside the right atrial or right atrial pressure. And during accident, during superficial cut wound of the neck. As this vein is superficial, if it is damaged or cut, its cut end remain open and air is forced to enter through this vein by the negativity of intrathoracic pressure, leading to what's called ear embolism. Thanks.